You may have seen recently I wrote a blog post on our blog about how Tuesday and Friday are my favorite days of SOCAP. And I realized I just needed to tell people that, because if you don't tell people, they're like, oh yeah, I'll get in Tuesday afternoon and then I'm kind of busy Friday. But these are actually the best days because I don't even know what happened on Wednesday and Thursday. They just fly by so fast, they're so overwhelming. So today, you're here bright and early, but it is sort of the like, take a deep breath, have that additional conversation with someone that you see as you're walking through. And we are starting off with an amazing plenary that's really looking out at sort of all of the things we've processed. Let's continue to look forward and think about the change that's on the horizon. And one of the most thoughtful and impassioned people I know who can speak to this and talk about the possibility and get us all excited to leave the conference and make more change and do more is Donna Morton. Please welcome Donna to the stage.
Thank you so much. Good morning. Thanks for making it here this morning. SOCAP has been quite the week for us. We went live on the New York Stock Exchange on Tuesday and have been trading at about 500,000 a day since, thanks to many of you, so I appreciate that. But before I get started, actually I need my little clicker. I think, can you guys advance the slide for me? Thank you. Before I get started, I want to recognize that anyone in North America actually lives on native land, and that today we're gathered in the traditional territory of the Ohlone Nation. So I started my career not in finance. I have a pretty unorthodox pathway to being a finance CEO, and I actually started working for Greenpeace in my early 20s. Not only did I work for Greenpeace, I actually was one of those people driving the Zodiacs and chaining myself to things. I got arrested every 5 weeks for Greenpeace, in fact, much to the dismay of my family. And I learned these really powerful lessons as a woman about actually using the power of my body to stop things that I couldn't stand in the world. And it was its own journey. And then I got burnt out. I got really tired of saying no, and I got hungry actually to figure out, well, what could I support? What could I actually get behind? I'm gonna move back a bit. What could I get behind and say yes to? My entrepreneur was kind of rising, and I wound up spending some time working on carbon taxes. I spent a decade on carbon taxes until the first carbon tax passed in Canada. I built a clean energy company that worked with indigenous communities. So in many ways, I'm a 30-year veteran of the climate movement. I've been working on climate change for 30 years. And my biggest reflection is that everything I ever worked on and anything most of us did really feels like too little and too late. We used a lot of scare tactics. Oh, something's really loud, and I'm not sure how to stop it, but I'll just keep experimenting until it doesn't sound bad. How about if I'm over here? Is that better? Okay, so basically, 30 years of working in the climate movement and feeling completely bummed out about what to do about it. And so I decided to take some advice from my mentor's mentor. Hunter Levins was mentored by Buckminster Fuller, and Hunter has been one of the most significant mentors to me, along with Joel Solomon, who you'll hear from later. But this idea of playing big, of looking at how cataclysmic the issues are in our time and figuring out, how do I become like Buckminster Fuller's trim tab, that little part on a rudder that turns the really big ship? Because this is a moment for us not to play small. And I would argue particularly women and people of color, anyone who's been left out of the dominant economy, I would argue actually has more creativity, more capacity to kind of come in and be disruptive. Because if you didn't build this broken financial system, you actually might have some really good, funky, out-of-the-box ideas. And people that have been in marginal capacities, people who have been left out, have had to struggle to be creative to survive. And that maybe those people have something intrinsically important to teach us about this moment in time. So for me, women are game changers. And the first game changer woman that I experienced as a girl was the television show Wonder Woman. She was a really big deal for me. It was a woman being generative, a woman acting from love and decency and kind of going out into the world and making things happen. And the film coming out this year, I don't know, it felt like a big deal. As we were building this finance company, I felt like when things got overwhelming, I could kind of put myself in a Wonder Woman stance and feel like it was possible for us to build a company that went out onto the New York Stock Exchange. But it's also when I look at the front lines of the social movements that I'm most inspired by, the Black Lives Matter movement, Standing Rock, the arts community, women are doing big things that are transforming our world. The leadership of women is having an incredible impact on the world. And so we built a finance company that's majority women. It's majority women on the team, it's majority women owned, it's majority women governed, and the majority of our investors are now women, which feels really different. And when we meet with people on Wall Street, it's one of the things that strikes people the fastest, is that there's something really, really specific about the power of women to change systems. Because we live in a zombie economy. I think we're obsessed culturally with this icon of zombies because there's something that aligns that we're not even thinking about. This deadened thoughtlessness, barely moving, barely thinking. We don't want to look at our financial statements. We don't even want to sometimes talk to our financial advisors because sometimes we don't like them. We don't like who they are. We don't like how they think. They don't actually listen to us, particularly if we're women. And this is one of those moments where we actually have to rise up and take our power back and look at our financial statements and talk to our financial advisors. And if they don't listen, we have to move our money. There's some really spectacular people in our family, in the First Affirmative Network, at Trillium Asset Management, at Verus, at Hip Investor, really thoughtful people that can help us align who we are with how we touch the world with our money, so that our money doesn't do hideous things and create murder and mayhem when we sleep. This was the quote that kind of changed my life in my 20s. Alice Walker wrote a book, a collection of essays called Anything We Love Can Be Saved. And somehow for me, I've needed to work in systems that were actually kind of hard to love. I worked on the tax system. Now I'm working on the financial system. It's not easy to reconcile being a creature driven by love and wanting to do love in the world with Wall Street. And we have to love Wall Street. We have to bring our deepest, most beautiful, the highest aspirations that poets have ever expressed and touch the financial system with that kind of sentiment if we're going to do what's needed. And we can't just divest from fossil fuel. The largest trend in the entire financial system is people have committed to divest $5.5 trillion from fossil fuels, but we also have to divest cancer-causing chemicals. We have to divest the mining sector, which is creating hideous indigenous rights abuses. We have to divest harm. We have to be really thoughtful and integrated about how we look at how we use our money. And we have to use the power of capital, carrots for the good companies, sticks for the bad companies, because CEOs pay enormous attention to stock price. And if we become powerful enough to affect stock price, I promise you we can change finance and change everything else. So people talk a lot about, I've worked a lot in indigenous communities, and people talk about the need to modernize indigenous communities. I actually think we need to flip that. I think this is a moment in time where we actually need to think about how to indigenize the modern economy. We need to learn from cultures that are 10,000 years old, cultures that have been living in place without trashing the joint for 10,000 years have enormous capacity to inform the way we think about money and everything else. And this is what we do. Tuesday, we launched CHGX, the Change X, fossil-free, large cap, ETF, a basket of stocks. We basically took the 1,000 largest companies in America, scrubbed out the 800 most scandalous, creating the most problems, with the worst human rights track record, or the worst labor standards, or the least capacity to understand the wisdom of women. And of that, we wound up with a 200 stock universe. Andrew Rodriguez and some other smarty pants financial analysts baked it into the 100 best. And what I would say is two things as I'm wrapping up. This is a product that represents the best of public markets. That's what stays in. We've divested from the worst. And then we have some really smart activist strategies, proxy voting, and shareholder advocacy to take what Andrew describes as the best of the not bad and make them a heck of a lot better. And so what we're really doing is inviting us all to think of ourselves as financial activists. This is a product made by financial activists for financial activists, a product made by women and millennials for women and millennials. We're going to gather, and we are getting some of the most prominent families in America from the 1% who are backing our play and buying this product. And then we're getting, you know, retired grandmas writing us notes saying, I can afford $50 to put into this product, and it sells for $18, and will you accept that? And the answer is, absolutely. And so we're trying to create a financial movement that starts with a product. Thank you very much for your time and attention.